Hello, my name is Nop, and these are my artistic influences for the Professional Cultures 2 class 2023. Let us begin. The first series in my artistic influence list is a YouTube series called Dynamo Dream, directed by Ian Hubert, with the first episode being called Salad Mug. Ian Hubert is a visual effects artist who predominantly uses Blender for his work. For the past almost 2 years, I have been learning this 3D software, and now I believe I am to the point where I am competent enough to spearhead most projects that I set my mind to. This series that Hubert is creating is fully done through Blender, with funding he gets from his Patreon supporters. Most of the shots in this episode are 90% CG, and it is amazing to see the behind-the-scenes shots of this project. It truly inspires me and represents what is possible using free software nowadays. In this VFX breakdown, we are shown one of the before and after shots from the first episode of Dynamo Dream. This contains so many details that I took into my understanding of how compositing should work. The first and clearest detail that I realized is the lighting. Hubert would match the real-world lighting that he is using on set to the CG lighting within the Blender scene in order to match the real footage to the CG footage. This technique is definitely crucial to making the two layers blend together. It would require extensive planning of the lighting in the Blender scene. Another impressive aspect of this clip is the space that he utilizes to make this scene. The main character in the scene uses an elevator to go up and down, which is able to efficiently showcase the 3D world that Hubert has created, while not needing an insanely large green screen. If Hubert wanted to showcase a 3D scene on par with the size of this one without the use of an elevator, the set that he would need to construct would be ridiculously expensive. The awareness that Hubert is able to demonstrate is another thing to marvel at. While shooting the real footage, Hubert must be aware of all the intricate details of his 3D scene and how the actors should be interacting with these details. Such as how after she gets off the elevator to go order the takeaway, Hubert is able to approximate the extent to which the elevator budges out to the right and not have the camera interfere with that 3D object. In the final part of this breakdown, as the woman is going back up the elevator, she turns her body to the right, but in the final shot, the camera shifts over to the right. This is yet again another clever way of utilizing his set. Due to the fact that he only has a green screen behind the actor in one angle, he instructs his actor to rotate her body in order to simulate the rotation of the camera within the 3D scene. Hubert's style of creating a 3D scene and utilizing a few actors behind a green screen is something that I would like to try. I've still not gotten around to compositing real footage within my 3D renders, and this VFX breakdown is something that gives me a lot of insight into how techniques like this are accomplished. The second entry in my artistic influence list is a film called Once Upon a Time in America, directed by Sergio Leone in 1984. Sergio Leone is an iconic Italian film director from the golden age of Hollywood. Prior to watching this film, I was accustomed to some of Sergio Leone's Western films, such as his Dollars trilogy and Once Upon a Time in the West, which I consider to be masterpieces in their own right. Once Upon a Time in America is his last film that he directed in his life, and is his venture within the Italian-American gangster film genre. The film follows our lead character Noodles, played by Robert De Niro, throughout the different stages of his life. We are first introduced to him in his 20s when he is in a Chinese opium den in New York City, and the film is presented to us as various flashbacks and flash-forwards throughout his life as he is getting high on opium. We are shown how Noodles starts out as a kid in New York City with nothing to his name, scrounging around for money all the way to him being a well-respected mafia kingpin, making his wealth through the acquisition and distribution of alcohol during the American Prohibition era. There are so many aspects of this film that I deeply adore and admire, but the main aspect that I put on a pedestal is Leone's ability to present his complex non-linear narrative in such an effective way. As you might know, when the film was first released in 1984, it had two versions. The director's cut, which was released in Europe, was 3 hours and 49 minutes long, and another cut for the American audience was 2 hours and 24 minutes long. The film tanked in the US, meanwhile the European critics recognized it for the enduring classic it now is. Despite the director's cut being a full 1 hour and 30 minutes longer, it just goes to show that a complex narrative like this requires the precision editing of the auteur that directed the piece. The tone that Leone crafts within this film is immaculate, especially in the scenes of Noodles as a child. There are countless shots accompanied by nothing but Ennio Morricone's masterpiece score that resonate deep within my soul. A musical motif that is prevalent in many of the tracks within this film is Cockeye's pan flute lick that he sometimes plays diegetically. It perfectly encapsulates the uneasy, restless mood that many of these characters experience when making their living on the fringes of the law. In the end, what I find so compelling about this film is the resolution, or rather, the fact that there is no real resolution. We never definitively get the answers we have been seeking throughout the runtime of the film. It is rather vague and up to interpretation. As Adam Smith from Empire magazine puts it, either way you read it, it's a film that deliberately offers no real resolution, only a sense of melancholy and which leaves the audience like Noodles, wondering, dazed, what it's all been about. The third film in my artistic influence list is a Thai film called Lung Bun Mi Ralukchat, or in English, Uncle Bun Mi Who Can Recall His Past Lives, directed by Apichatpong Wirasetakun. On Google, Uncle Bun Mi is categorized as a fantasy drama, but in my opinion, it is almost genreless. When watching this movie, I feel as if I have been transported into this world Apichatpong has created, fully immersive. The sounds of the crickets and Thai wildlife as a backdrop for many of these scenes remind me of my time in the Thai northeastern temples. I admire how Apichatpong is able to make me feel so appreciative of the life that I've been given, all the people that have come before me, and who I may have been previous to who I am now. It is a perspective that I don't think about too often nowadays, but it is definitely a point of view that is incredibly pertinent in my life. Apichatpong's ability to frame the Thai Buddhist perspective on reincarnation in a way that is accurate to many Thai people's beliefs are astounding. As a matter of fact, the film is incredibly hard to interpret and vague when it comes to explaining these ideas, but that is how it is in life as well. The film merely presents the simple idea of reincarnation and asks the viewer to draw their own conclusions. The film opens up with a long sequence of a domesticated water buffalo, escaping from being tied to a tree, wandering through the jungle for some time, and eventually being brought back by the farmer that owns him. The film takes an unusually long time focusing on the small, intricate actions this water buffalo takes, allowing the viewer to form some sort of attachment to this domesticated animal. Although it is never specified, this water buffalo could be interpreted as one of Uncle Bunmi's previous lives. This opening sequence is shot, acted, and paced perfectly. To me, the movement of the buffalo feels as if it has intention and a soul of something that is intelligent. I could feel the buffalo's desire to leave within the first 10 seconds of the first shot. The restlessness is clear. The way the buffalo runs across the frame is almost enchanting. This sequence was most probably shot as day for night, but the color correction and grading is immaculate. It feels as if it is almost sunset, but lighting like this was definitely not achieved through natural means. Apart from this opening sequence that inspired me heavily, there are so many other shots in this film that, despite their simplicity, somewhat due to the themes of this film, unnerves and calms me at the same time. I know those are two contradicting words, but I don't know how else to explain it. No other film has affected me as deeply as this one. The fourth entry in my artistic influence list is a film directed by Ridley Scott called Blade Runner. The critically acclaimed science fiction film that brought the cyberpunk genre into the world of cinema. What I love so much about this film is its full utilization of the science fiction world to delve deeper into the characters. Although the main draw of this movie is the world that surrounds it, the technology of the world is merely a vessel to explore the main question proposed in this film: what does it mean to be human? Although the themes of this film affect me deeply, the story has been adapted from the book Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep by Philip K. Dick, and it has been talked about to death, so I would like to delve into the set and prop design of the film. Ridley Scott commissioned Sid Mead to do the concept art for this film, but prior to starting work on the concept art for Blade Runner, Sid Mead was an industrial designer who had been commissioned to provide architectural renderings for mostly car, hotel, and furniture companies, including Ford Motors. When looking at the matte paintings and illustrations Mead did for this film, it is clear that Ridley Scott took enormous amounts of inspiration from Mead's work. Although Mead's work does not directly relate to the screen arts, I really value the importance he places on the design principles of the props within the world. Sid Mead states, and I quote, "It was sort of an exotic technological interpretation of a third world country, in a way. So everything looked sort of junky because you had to add things to constantly make it work. As the air got more polluted, or it rained all the time, you needed bigger windshield wipers, windshield washers, bigger air conditioning units, and anti-theft devices plastered all over the car. And so everything had this lumpy kind of retrofit look to it. And that's the look of the movie. This is one of the principles that I wish to apply to all my work, that every design principle within a project must have meaning and a purpose behind it. Things should not be placed within a scene of a film just because it looks cool. It must have intention and reason." I read this journal article that the quote prior was derived from a couple years ago, and it completely changed the way that I approach making objects and scenes within 3D softwares, and I have to thank the late Sid Mead for this revelation.
I hope you enjoyed. Bye bye.